It's always a pleasure for me and a privilege to be at the European University Institute. Sometimes I've been here almost as a free rider. Well, always actually, because I cannot say that I gave any long-lasting contribution to the activities of this institute, but I have benefited a lot from those who devote full or part-time their activities here. And in particular, I remember that in one of the positions I held for Europe, the position of Commissioner for Competition, I and my colleagues at DG Competition actually frequently used this institute, and in particular the Schuman Center, as very, very high level sounding boards to which submit our new ideas, our new proposals before going to the less authoritative bodies called Council and Parliament. And it has always been a very, very intriguing and rewarding exercise. It's also a great pleasure to see again here so many of you. Actually, I see all of you by definition, but with so many of you, I had previous occasions to interact. And also, I would like to, in particular, recognize for their role Secretary General Vincenzo Grassi, and for his very, very special role in my case, Professor Alfredo De Feo, because, where is he? There. Because I was at a loss when, for some mysterious reasons, at the beginning of 2014, 28 member states agreed that I should serve as chairman of this high-level group. And I was never really either expert in or excited by the budgetary issues of the European Union, I must confess. Although I had spent 10 years within the European Commission. And I cannot claim that I was altogether completely ignorant of economic and financial affairs in a broad sense, but I had managed skillfully, I must say, to go that far in serving Europe, always avoiding the unpleasant impact, I thought, with the EU budget. So it was very funny to be considered, for some reason, by all the 28 member states, the person who should guide this exercise and not really being a world-recognized expert in the EU budget. So I remember that I made a number of visits to people who knew, and the very first visit was to Alfredo De Feo in his piece of paradise in the library of the European Parliament. And probably he doesn't recognize a single word of his wise suggestions that he gave to me on that occasion in the final report, but I can assure you that you are more guilty than you presume in this final output. I will try to place this exercise in the broader context of the European Union, of its fortunes, and of its sometimes perceived misfortunes. the existence of this group is due, as many of you will know, to a clash between the European Parliament and the Council on adopting the seven-year multiannual financial framework 2014 to 2020, the one in which we are currently, because in the package of proposals initially put forward by the European Commission for this MFF, multiannual financial framework, there was also a number of proposals on own resources. But the Council did not really pay much attention to those proposals, and to throw them in the dustbin would perhaps be an impolite expression, but very close to the description of what happened. Even before the treatment of the MFF package reached the level of the heads of governments. And this was not different from the destiny given to proposals about own resources on previous occasions. And so that time the European Parliament said, no, this has to stop. The European Union will never grow adult if, like today, said they in 2014, it will have to depend for an increasing proportion of its financing purely from contributions of member states. So we need to make sure that next time round the topic of own resources is really seriously taken into consideration. So the Parliament withdrew its needed green light to the MFF until a solution was found with the Council, namely to set up a joint group by the three institutions which would consider the issue of own resources and keep it alive. So we know well that in many cases, setting up a committee is a way to delicately shelve proposals so that they please never come back. But in this case, because the dynamic which brought to the generation of this group, on the contrary, this was a commonly accepted pledge by the three institutions to try and be more serious about the topic in the future. This influenced a lot the composition and the nature of the group. For the first time, so at least I'm told, a group was set up jointly by the three institutions. There have been highly memorable groups in the history of the EU, but never had a group been set up by the three institutions, which of course implied some complexities and some skills in diplomatic terms being required, but allowed us to do something that with another structure would not have been possible. This, leave aside the adjective high level, which is never denied to any group being set up. But what matters is that this was not a technical group, not a group of experts, and the frame of three members designated by the European Parliament, three by the Council, three by the Commission, plus an independent chairman designated by the three institutions together, ensured that those were personalities selected certainly also on the basis of their familiarity with budgetary issues, and many of my colleagues were indeed more familiar than I was with budgetary issues at the EU level, but also with a psychological and institutional proximity to each of the three institutions. Then, of course, we had a lot of technical support by a joint secretariat of the three institutions, and each of them had a lot to contribute. We were able to contract out a huge study to a consortium of well-known think tanks in Europe, and we also used the possibilities of conducting hearings by inviting a fairly high number of experts to come and give witness to us. So we believe that what has come out is technically solid. But also I must say, there was not really the need to invent the wheel in terms of what possible new own resources could be, because there had been an enormous amount of academic and other work done over the years in the past. But the bit of the work which was never done was to move from the potential persuasion done in terms of analytical work to the hopefully effective persuasion done through policy and political arguments. And so much of our exercise consists in, of course, making all the needed reference to existing works, to works that we have commissioned. You'll find them all in the website of the group, but to devote a lot of time and, I hope, productive imagination to how make the case for own resources unavoidable, if not appealing. My modest experience in the European Union institutions dealing with topics which are particularly entrenched and difficult because they are protected by the unanimity rule, is that, of course, one has to arm him or herself with a lot of patience, with a lot of modesty in the ambition, but the fact that under a regime of unanimity, each member state, and there are still quite a few, can block the decision, does not mean that it is compulsory for member states to block the decision. So there is a veto there, a potential veto, which not always has to be exercised. Of course, this becomes a very, very narrow itinerary. But I sometimes remember the experience in the second half of the 90s of setting up the first package of tax coordination. Member states were only 15, which still is a high number. They were overprotected by the veto power, and yet all the 15, and on top of that, under Luxembourg presidency in the Council, arrived in December 1997 to a package which comprised the basis for what would have later become the Directive on Savings Taxation, and comprised a code of conduct on business taxation, which has then been gradually implemented in a voluntary cum peer pressure moral coercion among member states by a group of member states, of course, enlightened by the work of the Commission. And there were even the definitions which of what is a harmful or not harmful form of tax competition. Then the link was made, when I was at competition, between the notion of a fiscal advantage in a legislation of a country to the notion of state aid in the form of fiscal aid, then of course, as something is construed as state aid, we enter all of a sudden from the area in which the Commission is weakest and member states are strongest because there is unanimity, to the area where the member states are weakest and the Commission is strongest because there are the enforcement power of competition law and state aid control law. And so from that weak, modest, shy first step built in spite of unanimity by constructing a small package in which each member state would find a bitter pill but also a sweet pill for itself. And fortunately, they do not all have the same taste, the member states. From that, well, it was possible to arrive through steps and through a number of years to pretty powerful instruments like the one that the competition commissioner a few months ago applied to the case of Ireland in relation to the tax ruling with the Apple group. So this I say not as an advocacy of the joys of self-flagellation, although the season in the year approximates the one in which this reference might be appropriate, but I say in order to stress that with a certain degree of stubbornness it is possible perhaps to find ways in which the far from perfect powers that European institutions have can be deployed to the utmost of their potential effects. And so, coming back to our current, or now recently expired, group, we design a number of ways through which, in our view, it would be possible to construct a package of measures that could be somewhat palatable to different groups of member states. And we also, as was done in that previous exercise to which I referred, we also try to build a case for shaming the governments, which means here the finance ministers and then eventually the heads of governments, if they refuse to move in this area. And for example, all governments now existing in the EU, or virtually all, are scared by nationalism and populism. Of course, they tend to forget the high percentage of responsibility that each of them individually and all of them collectively have in this drift in the climate about Europe in their member states. But I will not go into this detail. The fact remains that it would be very incoherent for governments to continue to complain about populism, to continue to say that they want to fight populism, and then to continue to exhibit to our citizens a budgetary process constructed as it is now, which ultimately gives the impression that the EU is really what the critics pretend it is, namely a zero-sum game. When in the late hours of the night of a day X, the heads of governments come out of the marathon to make the agreement on the multiannual financial perspectives, they all go, as always, to their national press conferences, and the only topic of interest, I've seen this in February 2013 when I was representing Italy at the European Council and when the current MFF was finally decided. The only thing that matters to journalists, to the public opinion, is who were the winners, who were the losers. So in the case of the head of government of country X, the question is, did he do better or worse than the head of government of country Y or Z? And sometimes even more sexy, did the head of government of country X do better or worse than the head of government of that same country 7 years ago, which may have been of a different party or a different coalition? For example, in my case, I was up for judgment, the benchmark being my predecessor, Prime Minister Berlusconi, because 7 years earlier he was there. Which is always nice and stimulating to have comparisons, but this really ratifies almost officially in the eyes of member states that the EU is a zero-sum game. Nobody is interested in that moment in what programs of EU policies have been strengthened, which ones have been somewhat phased out. No. The game is il tiro alla fune, people would say in Italian, and so this very reductive thing. So, for example, one of our main efforts has been in the group to explain to politicians, because ultimately they should be our committed readers and are being, to explain to them how, in the end, devastating it is for the EU, for the image of the EU, but also for member states in the very end, that the predominant glasses with which the budget, the annual budget, the seven-year framework are looked at is the net payers, net contributors, and net beneficiaries. Because if that is the key of judgment, then of course this denies in its very root the idea that the EU might bring some value added to the member states, to the collection of the member states in isolation. And I would never have been interested to work for 10 years in an entity which would only have been a huge redistributive machine if it did not bring immense, difficult to measure, but I'm sure immense value added to the citizens of Europe through integration. And so we propose the shift, it will not be easy, But we propose the shift from from these lenses to look at the budget to the notion of the European added value. And this is not only a different perspective on the budget. We believe that this reflects the emerging challenges for the European Union. When I came here at the end of April 2015, which I remember well because it was my first return to life after a surgery I had had in the previous weeks, and I presented the state of play, that is the first assessment report that we were tasked to produce and had produced a few months earlier on a pure evaluation of the existing system of financing of the EU. Many of you or of the people who were here at that time were rightly disappointed, because they believed that we were coming here with proposals, whereas that stage of maturation of the work was just one of assessment of the existing system. And the assessment was very, very negative on a number of grounds, because the system, in our judgment, lacked simplicity, equity, democratic accountability, transparency, and so on. And if we had, and it would have been technically possible to do so, from that, if we had had to produce a report in the subsequent 3 months, rather than as the mandate prescribed, at the end of 2016, after having held an interparliamentary conference in Brussels with the European Parliament and delegations of all the national parliaments, which took place in September last year, if the process had been faster, it would have been perfectly possible to fulfill the mandate nevertheless. But I think there was something providential in the three institutions when they gave us the end of 2016. Why? Why? Because it was basically after I came here in mid-2015 and until, and things will continue, the end of 2016, when the report was produced, that so many new scenarios opened up for the European Union, most of them dramatic, with the nature of emergencies, but all of them, we are convinced, structural emergencies, because they are likely to persist for a good number of years, if not decades. There wasn't, when I came here, much concern for migration and refugees. The peak of the phenomenon, or the increase in the phenomenon, came later, and that became the top priority of the EU, which is hardly able to reason with more than one priority in the heads of the heads squares of government. That was migration and refugees. And there has been a hasted, disorderly run to find financial means, the package for Turkey, et cetera, because given the unadaptability of the 7-year framework, it wasn't possible to find out from ordinary finances the sums needed. So trust funds were added up, and we owe to the European Parliament to have produced a chart which is, please don't try to read it, but just get a visual impression on page 82 of the report. This is the mess of the budgetary structure of the EU. And on many of these satellites, not only there isn't likely to be water or liquidity for that matter, but there isn't control by the European Parliament. So no democratic accountability. The European Parliament has not decided on financing the package for Turkey. And somebody from France said to me the other day, when the finance minister of France goes to the Assemblée Nationale to ask for the authorization for the French bit of the trust fund for Turkey, it doesn't put the parliament in the position of having a discussion on the merit. This has been decided on Sunday in Brussels by our president with his colleagues. Please take note of this. So neither national parliaments nor the European Parliament have a voice. Then came, of course, the wave of terrorist attacks, so a new emergency having to do with internal and external security. Then came Brexit, which is, I believe, almost a tragedy for the UK and for the European Union, which necessarily implies a reconsideration of budgetary issues, both because there will be a gap created when the British contribution is over, but also because with the UK out, the memory of "I want my money back," notoriously pronounced by Prime Minister Thatcher in Fontainebleau in the mid-80s, should fade away. And that was the origin of a system, the British rebate was at the origin of a system of counter-rebates by other net contributors to reduce their contribution to the British rebate. And so, on both accounts, there will have to be a rather deep reconsideration of the budget. And then, of course, came President Trump with his clear in formulation, as always to be seen in implementation, and as always mild, moderate, and nice, comments on NATO and European defense, together with some pronouncement not really wishing all the best to the process of European integration, in particularly pronounced by the personality who is rumored to be proposed as US ambassador to the European Union. And so the always present issue of the European defense comes up in terms of priority and urgency, but like the other now structural emergencies, the need for a safer control of the external border, the need for more coordination of the intelligence systems of member states, the need for a more coordinated or unitary mechanism for asylum seekers and solidarity with migrants, and as well as defense. All of this requires, all of this, I would like to stress, has shown for the first time in many, many years that many member states are no longer calling for devolution from Brussels, or rather, they continue, in many cases, rightly, I believe, to call for devolution from Brussels for certain things, including many little petty programs that are politically nice to some constituencies, some members of the European Parliament, some governments, but which can hardly be justified in a European logic. But they say only the EU can provide to the provision of the European public goods, be they goods or services in their physical manifestation, that are asked increasingly by our citizens, like internal and external security. And we, member states, are not able to do so. This has changed perceptions and priorities so much that you will remember about 1 year ago, the most austere personality in the circle of finance ministers of Europe, who by definition on average are not the most jovial and expenditure prone people in Europe, Federal Minister Wolfgang Schäuble, came up with the idea there should be an intervention of the EU in terms of solidarity with those countries who are hit as temporary or even more so final destinations by the migrants. And if there is a need for money, why do not apply a European tax on gasoline? Now, a tax on gasoline is the thing that any desperate, junior, unexperienced finance minister coming to government in a situation of crisis thinks of. And I'm not sure that that would be technically the best solution, but I think it is very important to register this pronouncement of Minister Schäuble, because it indicates that all of a sudden there can be a readiness to consider things that until that moment were undoable, unpronounceable, perhaps even unthinkable. We therefore plead for a system which puts European public goods at the very center. We call, it was not in our mandate, but we call, and each time in the process I went to the ECOFIN Council, to the Parliament, to the national parliaments, in the numerous consultations we had, this came up. We propose that a very serious reconsideration of the structure of expenditures is done. Probably the times are more mature than in 2003 when André Sapir and others came up for the Prodi Commission with a bold proposal, which however was not preceded by paving the way with arguments as we try to do here. And of course, I hear, for example, people in France saying, well, maybe there is no longer reason to have through Brussels all those amounts for common agricultural policy. Some aspects of those policies could be re-nationalized. And this even for structural funds is being conceived. Now, let me conclude by saying that a report on own resources did not shy away from proposing own resources, possible forms of own resources. And we make a number of proposals, not all necessarily new. This is not an academic report which has to seek novelty. It is a political report which sought to reach novelty in the way in which it presents the topics more, I hope, cogently politically. And we have traditional as well as totally new proposals briefly in our report, extensively on the website, and basically they are these possible new sources of revenue through own resources are grouped by us in two clusters. One is related to the single market and fiscal coordination. I just give examples. A reformed VAT own resource replacing the existing one. A EU corporate income tax, once progress has been made, enough progress has been made on the common basis. For example, not necessarily a financial transaction tax, which, as was expected by my teacher at Yale, Professor Tobin, the author of this idea, would not have an easy path to implementation. He said it's going to be like the Loch Ness Monster. For a period it will disappear, then it will come up again, then it will disappear. He didn't live long enough to see the recent very strong emergence of the monster, I quote. And then a cluster of possible new own resources related to the energy union, environment, climate or transport policy. And then we also recommend not to neglect a particularly unsexy category called other revenue, unless one works by imagination, could then perhaps even become sexy. But other revenue, for example, includes the fines from competition violators. And I invite you to see the report. And by the way, for those who don't want to spend days or hours on the report, we produced a sheet with the main recommendations. In no more than 5 minutes, I would now wish to say, where are we going with this? The report has been finalized in December. It has been adopted unanimously. I stressed this in my transmission letter to the three presidents because it was far from obvious that three groups of three personalities, of course, each working on his or own or her capacity, but with a strong nexus with the respective institutions, would come to the same conclusions. And as you will see, the conclusions are pretty deep. You may agree or not with them, but they are not empty statements on which it is easy to find unanimity, European Council style. But they bite, and yet there was unanimity. And I have transferred this message in particular to the Parliament and the Council because these two institutions have always been at odds on these matters, and we unanimously reached the conclusions. And by the way, all our proposals can be adopted and implemented with the present treaty, which does not mean that we would not favor a change in the treaty, but we did not take as a group position on that because we wanted to be realistic for the short and medium term. To the extent that the decision makers will want to use this as a basis for their deliberations, they should have the encouragement that it's not a collision course, it's a convergence course. I think this is important. What are the next steps? Now, this report has been presented to the European Parliament, to the Council, in particular to the ECOFIN, and to the European Commission in a meeting of the College. We are now in a round of presentations of different nature. This one is particularly dear to me. Tomorrow there will be a CEPS meeting in Brussels where, among other things, this will be discussed. I've been, after the publication of the report, to the Senate in France, to the Conseil d'Etat in France. Something is coming up in Germany. I know that the Senate, to which I have the honor to belong, and who is represented here by the head of the research department, is already making some use of this report, and I presented it also to the highest Italian authorities. We have scheduled many other presentations. Whose task is to decide what to do with this? Basically, one person, the new commissioner for the budget in the European Commission, Commissioner Oettinger, who replaced on January 1st Commissioner Georgieva, who was a member of the group, a very lively and productive one, but now she is CEO of the World Bank. And so Commissioner Oettinger has already said in front of his own institution and the other two that he will consider this as the basis for his work. His work being to propose by the end of this year to the other institutions a draft MFF for the multiannual financial framework for the period after 2020, so from 21 on. When people, colleagues ask me, what is your feeling? Is your report being successful? We will know in a very, very long time, because this is not a work which will produce an immediate impact. The immediate impact is a positive impact, but it's not the relevant impact. When we go around, and especially in the institution, in the ECOFIN Council, which is probably the most difficult client, we had a very thorough discussion. Of course, each member state did not take position now, but from their questions, you can see the degree of interest and plausibility that this may be considered a strong ingredient. But then it will be for the Commission to present the proposal. In the group we had as the three representatives from the Commission, three rather high caliber personalities, the first Vice President Franz Timmermans, the Commissioner for the Budget, I mentioned already, Mrs. Georgieva, and the Commissioner for Economic and Financial and Tax Affairs, Commissioner Moscovici. So that's already a good bulk of the competences of the Juncker Commission. Then, but it is of course very important that there is an impact through the reflection of the decision makers in this area, the three institutions, but it is also very important that the broader public opinion, the academic opinion, the opinion of those who follow European affairs gets a view and transmits a view, positive or negative, on this. And I am pretty sure that the fully federalist component that I bet each of us has in his or her soul and mind will be somewhat disappointed. But the other component may be reassured under the heading pragmatism, because we did not want to elicit the enthusiasm of our beloved federalist friends, new treaty quickly, 100% of the resources through a new own resource directly levied by the EU. That would have been self-rewarding, keeping expectations very high, but I'm afraid a recipe for another 7 years without any change. I'm not sure that we will produce some change, but I feel, also on the basis of some experience due to age, that this way of proceeding may be apparently less ambitious, but probably more forthcoming in terms of results. Thank you very much.